demonstration school for now 3 years. This is our third year, and it's a national demonstration school where other schools come and they visit and they check out our classrooms and they see our AVID program in full effect. We have, you know, the same mission as AVID overall for the entire AVID program. Its mission is to close the achievement gap, and that's by preparing all students for college readiness. And this is something a lot of the times when, you know, you see all students will go to college, it's not necessarily always that they'll all go to college, it's that they'll all be ready so that when they get there, they possibly, you know, they have that chance to go to college, even if they decide to do something different and maybe go into the workforce, but they will be ready. I'm going to talk about a little bit of our school-wide commitments. And as a school, we tend to have all of our students use binders. We have all of our students do Cornell notes. And we even use, it's called a focused note-taking system, where they have to include objectives and standards and essential questions. And all of our students from 6th grade to 8th grade take these notes, and they take them in all of their classes. So not just in the AVID elective, but they also take them in math, in science, social studies, language arts, and even in their electives, band, choir, ceramics, and art. As far as, you know, our electives being reinforced, AVID's reinforced through an advisory class where students sit and they go through binders. AVID is also reinforced through the electives. So in art and in our computer labs, they're also being checked for binders to make sure that they're doing their Cornell notes, which is a strategy that, of course, AVID uses. Our wicker and our COSTAs, I brought a poster over here. It's for wicker, and wicker is for writing, inquiry, collaboration, and reading. But we don't just use this wicker in the AVID elective class. We also use it in all of our other core classes as well. And all of our site team is basically our staff members. So our AVID site team isn't just a collection of maybe one different, you know, teacher from every core subject. It's basically our entire school is our site team. So when we hold site team meetings for AVID, we invite everybody there. That way everyone can have input and everyone knows what's going on with our AVID classes. Professional development at our school. We have, you know, at every staff meeting, not just about every staff meeting, but for the most part, AVID will get up and will say something about what we're doing at the school. We also have teachers from other subject areas teach how they're using AVID strategies in their classes to put that out to, you know, other science or math, language arts teachers. And I'm on the leadership team as for my AVID program. And, you know, I make sure that what's happening whole school, we're getting our AVID strategies out there and that teachers are familiar or trained in AVID so that they can use the strategies in all of their classes as well. Some of the different strategies we also use in all of our classes are Socratic seminars. We use philosophical chairs, and these are also strategies from AVID. Our science, our social studies teachers use them as well to talk about the different curriculum, you know, the curriculum that they're studying at the time. We also push to have at least 85% of our students passing with C's or better. And one way we do that is we use what I've coined as mandatories. And basically, that's trying to get all students to be passing with C's or better in every single one of their classes. And for my AVID program, and it was something you were hearing today in with our keynote speaker, but he was talking about how you don't just do intervention after the students are failing, but you basically put it into place while the students, while you see the students struggling every single day. So one of the things that we do is every 2 weeks we look at their grades, and we look at all of the, you know, all of the AVID students' grades, and we see, is there a student like on the edge? Are they at C's already? Are they at C minus? Do they need to come up? Are they already at a D or an F? And every 2 weeks we'll pull them into something that I call mandatories. As far as establishing rigor, AVID's huge on rigor. It's not an intervention. AVID is to challenge the students. So when the students come into AVID, it's all participation, and the students elect to be in the AVID elective. And when they go into the AVID elective, we push them into some CP, college preparatory classes, maybe honors classes, and we put them in those classes, and then we help support them in the AVID elective so that they're doing better, so that they are being challenged, and if they start to struggle, that we support them through tutoring and the interventions we put in place. this basically through the AVID elective, we do the rigor of Cornell note-taking. We have students always taking notes in all of their classes, and it's an expectation of the entire school. So when students come into the AVID program, they don't need to just take class notes for me, but they also need to take class notes for every single teacher. Even if the teachers aren't asking them to take notes, they still have to take notes. They have to have C's or better in all of their classes. They need to basically check in with their teachers if they're not doing well. And the teachers check in with me too. So I'm kind of like their second mom, these students. I check in, I say, how are you doing? Are you struggling? And then I talk to their teachers for them. So they have, you know, extra support through me and then through the collaboration of all the teachers to support the students in those harder classes. This is one of the nights that I do. We do a lot of parent nights, and the parent nights are to get the community involved, get the parents involved. And this very first one I do in September, it's a mandatory night, and it's for all of the AVID students to come. And the parents learn about what AVID is, and then they get a feel for what their students will be doing for the rest of the year and how they can help support their student throughout it. And then we do a special picture at the end to do a student with a cap and gown on, and we make them into magnets, and we have the year that they're actually be a college graduate, and we give those to parents around like Christmas time, kind of as a gift, so they can put them on the refrigerators to remind them of, you know, what their goal is. So when it gets hard and they start to struggle, they can look back and say, okay, this is, you're wanting to be a college graduate. 2020 is the year it's going to happen. Let's just keep pushing on, keep, you know, taking the harder classes and get the help that you need to make that dream come true. They also sign a contract, and the students need to, you know, fully participate. And so they agree to be able, or they agree to try as hard as they can to meet these goals, to do these responsibilities, and to pass with C's or better in the AVID class, and to continue with AVID for the 3 years they're in middle school, with the hopes of also going into high school AVID for 4 years to graduate and then to go into college. So basically they all sign this, we read it together at this night, and then the parents sign it, the counselor signs it, I sign it, the principal signs it. We even have college students that come to tutor in the class. They're there, they sign it, and basically it's just to really reinforce that all of these students are here for the common goal of succeeding and getting to college, even at the middle school level, which, you know, it's really a new thought for these students, because they're not thinking about college yet. They're just trying to get through middle school. They're not even thinking of high school yet. So to think, wow, I'm going to go through this program, I'm going to get into high school, and then I'm going to go into college, and it's starting now at sixth grade, it really, you know, starts to drive them to do well in their classes, where they might not have had that drive before. These are the mandatories I was talking about. Basically, it's saying if you have below a C-, and I check every 2 weeks, you need to come and get some help. And you can go to that teacher that you're not doing so well in and get help. You can come before school and get help with me. You can stay during lunch and get help with me or any of your teachers that are willing to do it. Or you can stay after school and get help. But you have to come, because we need to get some support there so that you can pass these classes. So generally, I tell them it's going to be about 2 hours per week minimum until their grade goes up. So then we'll check again the next week. If their grade's up, they're out. If it's not up, then they continue to come back so that their grades rise. And sometimes there's those teachers that say, well, they're missing 12 assignments. They're not making anything up. We don't take late work. But for the AVID students, they do make exceptions, because they know most of these students that are in these classes are they're middle to average to higher achieving students. And some of them, you know, algebra for the first time, eighth grade algebra is a rigorous course for them. And, you know, other eighth graders are in geometry, but they're taking algebra and it's rigorous. So basically, the teachers will give them a chance to make up some of the work, because they know they're an AVID student and they know that they're determined to do well. And so we have them, you know, again, get some exceptions so that they can get their work done and get the get these hours done so that their grades come up so they're passing again. Some of the roles and responsibilities. Students, basically the responsibility is to uphold the contract that they signed, to make sure that they're getting their assignments turned in, to make sure that they're passing their classes with C's or better. Parents are there to check their binders, to check their planners, to make sure they're talking to teachers if they see their child struggling, and to be there for, you know, communication with parents if we have teacher-parent conferences. teachers are supposed, you know, they're there to be available to the students at all times. About 80% of our teachers at our school are actually trained in AVID. So with that, they know that they need to be available. They need to be there for the students. And so whether it's before school, after school, or during lunch, they provide time for these students to get help if they need it. The counselor is there always to make schedule adjustments if a student needs it. You know, it's not just, oh, our schedule is set. If a student's doing really, really well in his regular classes, well, let's put him in honors classes now. He needs a challenge. Or he's really, really struggling in honors classes. Just because he's advanced doesn't mean he can take the honors classes right now, so we'll drop him back down to a regular class if that's what's more rigorous, where he can be successful. So the counselor makes sure that there's always room for the student to move where they need to move that best fits each individual student. And then the tutors, that's a great part about AVID. It's the only program I know of so far that has college students that are hired to come into the class. And these tutors come in about 2 days a week, and the students get help in small groups, about 6 to 1. So there's groups of 6 students, and they collaborate together, and then there's a college student in there to help with each group, to help the students learning and help facilitate their learning. So during these tutorials, we call them, the tutor comes in, and then the students bring any questions they have from math or science or social studies or language arts that they're struggling with in those more rigorous classes, and the tutor will sit and help facilitate the learning and help them understand maybe what they couldn't in a class of, you know, 50, because our class sizes are up. They're anywhere between 40, sometimes up to 48 students in a class, and a lot of the students don't have time to raise their hand and say, I need help with that one part of that question, but they can come into my class and say, okay, I need help with this one part of this question, and there's a small group of 5 students sitting with that student to help, and then also a college student or a college tutor to help. So it really helps out the students to understand what they're learning in those other classes. Tutorial consistency, basically the students use the same type of tutorial request form, and the tutorial is just, they say, this is what I need help in math, or this is what I need help in language arts, and they write the questions down, they say what they know, they say where they're stuck, and then they bring that to the group 2 days a week. And with that, you also have the same actual tutorial request form through 7th and 8th, and then also into high school through 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th. We all follow the same system. So it's really easy for the students to roll straight from 8th grade into the 9th grade AVID program, because they're going to be doing the exact same type of request form, and they just pick it up so much faster. They can get help directly and quickly when they start that freshman year, because they already know how to ask for help. They already know how to do it. So it really helps them to stay in the program and be able to do that straight into our feeder school. Expectations for all the students is basically the same. The tutors, we expect, you know, they're always professional. Some of them are from, you know, just surrounding colleges. And the students treat them as teachers. I mean, they're in the class to help give their time to teach the students whatever it is the students are struggling with. And the student and the tutor have a very high respect level between the two of them. So it's really nice. This was something that we put together as a, not just a school, but also as a district. We put together a report to our board because we wanted to share with them more about how successful we were, not just as a school, but how successful the entire AVID program was at the district, because we didn't think that the DO really knew what we were doing and how successful we were being. So we got together, not just our school, but all the middle schools and high schools that had AVID at the time, and there was only a few that didn't, which now they do. But at that time we got together and said, okay, let's share with them how much we've helped students improve. And we went there to gain support of the district, because hopefully one day we'll have money being passed down from from them, but let me show you what we put together. We basically, and we're going to be doing this again this year, but we always see our numbers a lot higher than the general population for AVID. So for instance, this one is from our school, and what we did is we took AVID out of the general population, and then we compared it to the school. And we said, you know, when we look at math proficiency, 66% of the AVID students are proficient, and 77 are proficient in language arts. When you look at the school, just the general population, the non-AVID students, only 37 are proficient, and only 38 are proficient in language arts. So, and it's not because these students are the proficient students. They're not the ones that we're taking into the program. They're the ones that might be the basic, or you know, the lower basic, that need the actual push. They need the extra support. And so we give that to them in the AVID elective to push them up and to see them become proficient. ADA, 97 compared to 95, which is huge. It can mean millions of dollars for a district. If the students are there, the AVID students tend to want to be there. They know that their grades matter. They know they want to get to college. And there's a lot of fun incentives, too, that we include in the program, such as field trips to colleges. We do end-of-the-year rewards. We have a lot of special functions that go on at school. So they want to be there every day. And I have kids show up. They're still sick, but they're like, no, I need to be here. So, I mean, our ADA is up always, consistently, every year with the AVID students, more than general population. Referrals and disciplines, same thing. AVID students, they're always a lot lower every year, and GPA is always a lot higher. This was just another school in our district. We showed the same thing for them. Numbers spoke for themselves, higher in every single category as well for Santa Fe Middle School. And we're located in Hemet, the Hemet Unified School District. So this is one of the middle schools there. Acacia Middle School, the other middle school that's had it since like 1996. AVID's been in that school. Again, same thing, numbers up. For the high schools, the number of students just taking the PSAT and completing the A through G requirements. AVID makes sure that these students do this. The regular population, there's no one making sure that they're doing this, except AVID says, no, you have to take the PSAT. You have to get the A through G completion, the A through G requirements. Because most of the time, the counselors are saying, well, we just want you to graduate high school. They're not saying we want you to graduate high school but be able to go into college necessarily. So for this, 100% of the AVID students have to take the 4 years of math, where high school requirements only say three, but we make sure that they're ready for college. Same thing with the other high school. Again, 100% SAT participation, 100% A through G requirement. This was the very first year this other high school had started, and they didn't have the PSAT or the A through G yet, because they started with a 9th and 10th grade class. They didn't have an 11th or 12th grade class, but they still had higher rates of student participation coming to school, and also definitely a higher GPA. This one here is showing the growth, and this is the growth from 04 up through 08, and it's been steadily increasing as well. And basically this shows how many students we had over the years through West Valley and Diamond Valley. So this is our school, the middle school, and this is the high school, and you can just see how our numbers keep growing. Students hear about AVID and they want to get in it. So the next year we have a higher number of students that want to be a part of this program. The retention rates are continuing also to go up. The students that have been in the year one, been in the program 1 year, they want to be in it the next year. They want to be in it the following year. So our retention of students that have been at least in it for 2 years in a row and going up is, 13% in 07, all the way down to now 95% of them have stayed in the program through 2011. This is last year's AVID Senior Achievement. These students were offered scholarships and awards up to $3.2 million. And that's for every scholarship or every award that they applied for that they got. And these students, every single one of them, went into a military school, went into a UC, went into a Cal State, or went into a JC. And 100% of them went on. And a lot of them had, I think we even had last year from the West Valley, a Dell Scholar, and the Millennium, the Gates. actual Gates scholarship too.
I just want to kind of talk about, I think this is a program that's fairly unique to our school, and we started it, I want to say it was this is my fifth year doing it, so 6 years ago. And the reason we did it is our AVID program was solid. Those kids were doing their binder checks, they were really organized, but what we've noticed was the kids that weren't in the AVID were really struggling with organization. They were losing papers, losing homework, didn't know how to take notes. So what we thought was, let's create what we called a pre-AVID class, teach them these skills, and hopefully we'll see some of an improvement. The first year we did it, there was another teacher who did it, and it was a full year course, and he struggled a little bit with it because he didn't really know what he was kind of doing with it. And I took over the next year, and one of the things that we changed about that was we put it in the computer lab. We added a technology piece to it where not only was it the AVID core stuff, the reading, the writing, but we incorporated computer skills with it as well. And we found that the kids really bought into it. So, like I said, this is the fifth year that I've been doing it, and it's an elective for sixth graders, and basically what happens if they don't have Ms. Christensen for their AVID elective that they applied to, they get me in sixth grade, and they get me for a semester. And then they'll flip-flop with the art teacher, so they have art for a semester, me for a semester. And we teach these AVID skills right away, the organization, the binder checks, the planners. That's something that is a constant struggle, is just to get those kids to fill out their planners every day. So that's something I check on a weekly basis to make sure, and sometimes a daily basis depending on the kid, to make sure that they're getting, they're filling out their planner, they're doing their binders correctly. And then the technology piece, like I said, is something that we've added, and that's very unique to our school. We do a lot of talk about college. And we have a lot of our students, socioeconomically, what are we at, 65-70%, somewhere in there. So they come into middle school and they've never, ever even considered that college could be a possibility for them. And we do a lot of research about college, a talk about college. I'm a very proud University of Wisconsin graduate. I'm constantly talking about Wisconsin sports, things like that, where Monday, of course, I had probably 20 kids come in. It's like, Mr. Snyder, did you see the game on Saturday? Did you see the Hail Mary? I'm like, yeah, thanks for reminding me. But it's something that we just introduce them to. And, you know, and I'll show you some of the projects they're doing here in a little bit. And then finally, the last thing is we really try to then push these sixth graders who didn't apply to Ms. Christensen's elective class to apply in seventh grade. And we see a fairly high percentage of these students then apply to her year-long elective class, which they take down on seventh grade, and a lot of them stick with through eighth grade. All right, so this is just a little bit about the students. Like I said, it's every sixth grader. They'll get me for a semester, unless they have Ms. Christensen for the AVID class, which they apply, or some of the band students. But like Sarah said earlier, one of the things that in the electives that we do is every teacher does binder checks every 2 weeks anyway. So it could be the band teacher, it could be the art teacher, the ceramics teacher. They're still doing that binder checks, because that was one of our goals that we set a couple years ago, was to make sure that every student is going through the AVID process. It's a semester long, and like I said, the goal is to eventually move the kids into the elective program the following year. This is just, you know, a couple pictures that we've taken. My classroom, like I said, I really promote the college. I have 71 different either college banners, posters. I really promote every Wednesday we have college shirt day at our school. I'm getting more and more sixth graders buying into that. You'll see these on each of the slides. These are what I call Big Ten Bucks. And Sarah talked about a lot of the incentives she has in her AVID class, and I kind of wanted to do the same thing in the pre-AVID classes. So this is kind of the money that they earn in my classroom for earning good grades and binder checks, behaviors, like if I'm gone today with the substitute, the class is good, they're going to get extra Big Ten Bucks, things like that. And what they do then is they can use those at the end of every triad to buy school supplies from me. Tabs, paper, pencil, rulers, whatever they need to get. It's something that my incentive for them, and it really, really works out well with the kids, because they love collecting these. They love looking at them. They're always asking me about the different schools and whatnot. So that's just something that one of my incentives that I use for the sixth graders. And once again, it's promoting college, getting them thinking about college. As far as the course goes, a lot of the AVID strategies, so there's a lot of the reading comprehension. We do a lot of step up to writing, and you'll see that with the technology component. I'm always trying to incorporate either a step up to writing, something core with math. We'll do Greek mythology with the social studies, natural disasters and science if it's a PowerPoint. Everything that we do as far as the technology goes, I try to incorporate some of the core, okay, whether it's the math, science, language arts, or social studies. And then finally, with a technology component, since it's a semester, we do the basics. We teach them Word. That's one of the things that we talk to the 7th and 8th grade teachers is, you know, kids don't know how to set up papers that they turn in, you know. They don't have the correct font. They don't put on the right-hand side. And it's something that we assume that they know, but they don't. So we teach them these basics. PowerPoint, like I said, you'll see a couple of examples of some of the different PowerPoint. And then I love Microsoft Publisher, so we'll do some Publisher in the class, and the kids are just shocked with everything you can do with Publisher, and you'll see some examples. And then finally, we just got this program this year. This is a Compass Learning program. What it is it's a math and language arts. It's kind of a remediation, but what it is that the students take what we call a MAP test we have at our district, and based on their level, this program assigns whatever lessons based on their level. So if they're struggling with fractions, they get fractions. If they're struggling with reading comprehension, they get lessons on reading comprehension. And this is something that our district's really pushing this year and that we've decided to incorporate in the pre-AVID and it will start to in the AVID classes as well. These are just some examples of things that we do in the class. We just finished up with this a couple weeks ago. This is a student newsletter they did. This was in Publisher. This started off completely at scratch. And the students had to, we created the mastheads. They learned how to put in the pictures. They set up their table of contents, the borders, the backgrounds, which they all loved. But most important were these paragraphs. And these were step up to writing, topic sentence, fact, detail. And, you know, we spent a whole week going over, editing, making sure they knew how to do this. And that's like I said, trying to support the language arts classes. And this was another one of our goals that we set was the step up to writing. And so, and the nice thing about my class is there's a lot of freedom. So they kind of get to pick, they talked about, they had to write one about their family. But the other two, which I didn't put on, they had two pages of this. They could write about whatever they wanted. So we're bringing that connection from home, things that they're interested in, and incorporating that as well. This is my favorite project of the year, and we're just finishing up with this. These are the college brochures that we're currently doing. Once again, talking about college, getting the kids starting to think about college. And they pick four different schools they do research on. They learn how to put in all the information. School colors, nicknames, things like that, fight songs, enrollment. And then finally, once again, most importantly is the reasons why to go to college. And they set up that step up to writing, and they talk about three reasons why. And yesterday, I was actually just, one of the girls were just finishing up one of these. And this really touched me, which is like, and most importantly, the third reason why I want to go to college is I want to be the first person in my family to go to college. I want to make my parents proud. And she's like, I never thought that I could, but seeing this and doing all this research, now I think I can. And it really kind of touched me. And I was like, oh, wow, that's absolutely amazing. So this is the brochures we're doing. So you want to go to the next one? PowerPoints, like I said, I try to incorporate all subjects. So I teach them the basics of PowerPoints, and on this particular one, this was order operations. They were doing a PowerPoint on PEMDAS, so they learned how to create the PowerPoint, but then they were also getting the sixth grade math standard with order of operations. And then finally, we try to have some fun in there. This is the last project of the year that we do, the semester that we do. And in this one, they designed their own Wheaties cover. And, you know, they took the picture, they learned all of this was blank, this is not a template, they learned how to do all that, background, text box, all this stuff. And this is just, once again, some more students on College Wednesdays. We got an email from our district about 3 weeks ago saying that all the schools needed to update their web pages because beginning of the year, get so busy, blah, blah, blah. Well, being the type A's that all we are, we're like, we're not going to update our website, we're going to completely redo the website. So I'm the technology coordinator of school, so one of the things we decided to do was with our website really, focus on the college. So one of the things we did on the website then was where the contact information is, you know, here's Mr. Parker, he's our algebra and geometry teacher. We went through, asked every teacher their favorite college, what they attended, so when the students are looking at or the parents are looking at this, you know, we're showing the college, okay, getting the kids excited about college. So wherever they go on campus, they're seeing something promoting college. And it's something that we really, really set forth as one of our goals the last couple of years, is to promote the colleges on campus and to make sure that the students see that. And, you know, teachers, there's a huge buy-in with the teachers. They're always wearing their college shirts. You know, we like to talk a little trash back and forth with the teachers, and the kids love it. I have one teacher that Mr. Sox and I are going back and forth. He attended Indiana, I attended Wisconsin, and there's a constant back and forth, but the kids relay the message and they love it. So it's just something that we're constantly promoting the college at our school.
Our AVID tutors also work after school in our SAFE program. So I don't know if you all have SAFE, but it's a grant that we have it within our district, and our students come. Our school gets out at 3:20, so they come from 3:30 to 6 o'clock. And 3 days a week, our high school AVID students are paid by the district to come in and tutor our students. So not only does she have the tutoring during the day, but we all also have it after school. The interesting thing about it is, because the district has supported it, any student in our school, even if they are not in the free and reduced after school program, are eligible to come and work with those tutors also. And another thing that was really nice about it is Sarah had the mandatories, and we had teachers that had their own homework tutorials after school. But a group of teachers came to me and said, you know what, we want to borrow what Sarah does with her mandatories, and also what Granger in San Diego, their program, and the ZAP program, zeros are not permitted. So we started at the beginning of the year, it's new this year. And what happens is the teachers, it's voluntary, the teachers do the same thing that DeVore was saying. Make sure your interventions are timely. If a student has a zero in a class, they haven't done their homework or their classwork, they know that on Tuesday and Thursday they will come after school. The teachers set up a contract with the parents agree, and we all go into the MPR. So we started with maybe 4 teachers at the beginning of the year. We're now up to 12 teachers, which is really nice for 7 weeks of school. Some of the other teachers still want to do their own tutorials, tutoring in their own classrooms. But you can walk into our MPR 2 days a week, and you will see 75 to 100 students sitting in the MPR, all doing their homework. It's not punitive. You'll see all the teachers in there, and it was working so well, I went to the campus supervisor and I said, what do you think about bringing the after-school detention kids in? Just have them come in. It'll be one more person in the MPR, and just tell them they have to do their homework and have them see everybody else. So instead of me, I first went to the campus supervisor to see what she thought about it, and then I went to the ZAP teachers because I wasn't going to force it on them, and I said, what do you think? Can we invite these kids in also? Because they're there for more discipline reasons. And so it works out really well. They just come in, they sit. We fill up the whole MPR so they sit more together on one side, but they're treated just like any student there. And it's amazing. They get out their homework, they do their homework. And here's the thing, it's very simple. If you don't have homework, then you do a 4-paragraph step up to writing essay. No problem. So we don't have to argue with the detention kids. Because, you know, the ZAP teachers will bring the classwork for the students to make sure they have it. But the detention students, and it's amazing how quickly they find their homework once you tell them they get to create their own step up to writing. And step up writing across the curriculum is one of our school goals this year. So we have writing with it throughout the school and all of the departments. So that's one of the things that they set up. It's built into our single school plan for achievement. When she showed you those slides, they looked a little old because they were from 2008. To become a demonstration school, you have to show that you have district funding. You have to show you have district support. And that's why we went together. So we were very fortunate. 2 of our schools on the same year became national demonstration schools. So it's the middle school and the high school, West Valley. They're our feeder school. And we've worked very closely with the school to make sure there is a bridge with the program to move those students on. And so that's why, even though it's old, it's very important to us to still show for people that are interested in bringing in the program what you need to do to be able to get validated as a demonstration school. This is my 4th year as a principal, and I was the assistant principal at the high school West Valley, and so I oversaw the AVID program at the high school, and Christy Gonier, who's now in Beaumont, and Sarah worked with it at the middle school. So there was already a culture shift before I became the principal, but what we saw was we wanted to really take it school-wide, and it works well. So we create these things to get all of the students to be able to participate. And one of the things is we have data teams this year, and so Ann Marzano's strategies, and one of them is Cornell Notes. But what we're trying to do is take it to a deeper level. So when you have your Cornell Notes and you go and do your summaries, your summary can't be just two or three sentences. It has to be a step up to writing paragraph, where actually you're giving evidence that you can show that you learned something, as opposed to just taking notes from a teacher talking to you. So it works well. It's a nice shift. We do have our site meetings. All of our staff meetings are data meetings now. So 2 days a month, and that's actually what's happening right now. We have the first week of the triad and the fifth week of the triad, we have our common formative assessments, and they're by departments or grade level. And the teachers come up with it, and they will pick different strategies. So they're causal strategies where they're showing the link from the pre to the post assessment. A lot of times fall back on our AVID strategies. So for example, we also use a direct interactive instruction, think, pair, share. But what that is that's a student engagement strategy. It's not necessarily a causal strategy that will show how on a pretest you've actually moved to a post-test, and you can actually show the link in learning. So that's what we do 2 times a month before school, and then we have a release day once a month for our teachers to also come in on their data teams. And again, it's a real link with that AVID strategies. So it's a whole school participation. All the staff knows, and it's sort of what he said. What was the word DeFore used today? Collaboration and coercion. Is that the word he used? Yeah, coercing people to do things. I think that's sometimes how the staff feels. You know, okay, we've got to go to the meeting. We have to do all this. But they're beginning to see the benefits of it, and so it works well. One of our goals is we're a program improvement school. And what we saw was we were focusing so much on academics that we wanted to do a cultural shift and focus on, like Chad said, let's have fun, let's have some incentives. So we have brought in different ones this year. We've had ones in the past. Now, maybe you all do this, but we got a new photographer at our school, and he brought us like 100 front of lunch line passes that he made for us. And what we saw was that one little thing, front of lunch line passes, totally changed the culture of our school. Now, I know this is going to sound weird, but we give out 250 front lunch line passes now a day. Now, we have two lunches, and as adults, we're saying, that's crazy. Why would anybody want to use it? Well, instead of having two lines to go into lunch, we have one line, but really we have two lines because the other line is all the front lunch line passes. So if the kids do any type of act of kindness, if somebody drops their notebook and somebody picks it up, or if they go by and they pick up trash at the school, or if they walk up to the principal and say, good morning, Mrs. Ballinger, how are you today? Those types of things. Oh, what do you know? Magic front of the lunch line pass comes out. You need to clean up your lunch tables. All you need to do is say, who would like a front of the lunch line pass? And then all they do is walk up to the attendance window and ask for it, and they get the front of the lunch line pass. It's amazing the miracles that it does. We changed the advisory this year. The advisory used to be 13 minutes, 12 minutes. Now it's 6 minutes in the morning and 6 minutes in the afternoon. And that's because we have to work from bell to bell. But it was hard to give incentives. So the last 6 minutes of the day, students can be released early. The last 6 minutes of the day, we have all of our campus supervisors go to their stations. So if somebody gets released, the crossing guard's already there, students are, you know, everybody's already in place for the safety reasons. It's amazing. In addition to that, when the students are there, the teachers that have prep go around and sweep all the kids that need to go into ZAP. They sweep all the kids that need to go into detention. So all those students make it there. But we had it in the past when I started, but because of school, with the budget cuts, we had fewer and fewer people who could do sweeps. So it was getting, like we get out of 3:20, so it was getting they were getting picked up like at 3:05. So we wanted to make a change so everybody could, it wouldn't intrude on instruction. So it works well. We have Kona Ice that comes a few times a year and helps the students. And I wanted to be able to start empowering the teachers more. I knew what the teachers were doing and how great they were on my staff, but it was interesting the other staff members didn't know. So this year I reached out to the teachers and I said, what do you want to do? So for example, one group of teachers wanted to start Zap. Another group of teachers wanted to do Ruby Payne's DeVore, Culture of Poverty. Another group of teachers wanted to take the incentive program, so they have their own committees. And they all have their committees, and then they bring it to us and say, these are the changes we want to bring in the school. We had budget cuts for athletics, so we have teachers that now volunteer. So we still can have those types of programs where we're working. We're having Frisbee tournament is coming. We have basketball. We have track. So we have a lot of things that are coming to the school. And it's all tied to the whole culture of college, athletics, with academics, all around AVID. And the other thing is that we have a community partnership, which is really important. So we brought in community service into the AVID program, but we've taken it school-wide. So what happens is we have a lot of parents that have to go to work, and Hemet's really, really big, and they have to drop their kids off very early. School doesn't start until 10 minutes before 9. But our students are at our school at 6:30 in the morning, and our parents are very worried. So what we do is we have a partnership with the elementary school that's next door. And Sarah's really good at getting her AVID students to be able to get their community service. So we have 30 to 40 students that go over first period to the elementary every day and work in the classroom with the teachers. And then we have other students who want to do it. Their GPA isn't that great. They may have some discipline issues, so we make a deal with them. If you can show us you can behave, we'll give you the chance to go over there. But if you can't, then, you know, we're going to have to take that away from you for a while. And then the other thing that we've started this year is Yes, I Can. Yes, I Can is a program where special education students buddy with regular education students. So the AVID students will work with them. We have students that go in at lunch, meet with them. And then we have it at both of our high schools. So we're now bringing it down to the middle school.
This is a quote I always like to share with all my students at the beginning of the year. And basically, I just remind them of this quote. I've seen it quite a few different ways, but basically the idea is the definition of insanity is doing the same thing again and again, over and over again, but expecting a different result. And so I always start the beginning of the year saying, look at where you ended last year. You're living in results at this moment. Like what you did last year got you to that end, and where you are starting today is a fresh slate. And so if you want to see yourself where you ended last year again this coming year, then you should do exactly what you were doing. But if you'd like to see yourself somewhere different, maybe you want to improve or you want to challenge yourself, then you have to do something else. Like you have to learn to study differently. You have to learn to take different notes. You have to learn to communicate with your teachers. But that's how I start every year, and it's the same for teachers, and it's the same for administrators, it's the same for anyone working in any business or working at any school. It's basically, if you like where you are at this moment, then continue doing what you're doing, but if not, you just must change something or you will get the exact same result the following year, or by the end of the following year. So those are my questions to you. What results would you like to see at the end of next year if you're a teacher or you're an administrator, or you know, in your job or in what you do and your successes? And would you do it differently? Would you start doing something differently today if you wanted to achieve something else by the end of this year? So just things to think about as far as what you expect for yourself for this following year. And I think about that every day.